So, what I want to be able to take away from today is that how a nephrologist approaches hypertension. 95% of the departments on nephrology also are called the departments of nephrology and hypertension when in the medical school. And very few of all tend to be called cardiovascular hypertension. So, the majority of the lay folks, when they think of hypertension, they think that a cardiologist is going to take care of it. Where in fact, when the blood pressure management becomes difficult, you get a phone call. You're going to be hearing a lot about secondary causes of hypertension when you get out there and stuff like that. Mainly because the patient has a very difficult time managing the blood pressure management. You can live in a very situation in today's world because we have so many medications to choose from. But it's also unlucky because you may choose the wrong medication. You may choose the wrong medication. That's why another thing is often that there's no hookbook method approved for Rachel Red, Yada, Money by Hope to the day. I'm not high blood pressure, and this is happening like your people that your clinical blood pressure skills that you're going to go on and the decision making process is all going to be what you think is wrong. There are several forms of several ways of going about being high blood pressure, and the first thing to do is there's several ways of going about it, and there's recommendations that the National Committee put together every several years when you want to go on a trip or you want another to spend your money, they want to then decide and determine what medications or how they're going to go about changing things. We're still years away from true management of high blood pressure. Everyone in this room, all of the healthcare providers that are out there. We're very, very far away from treating high blood pressure in an appropriate fashion. The main reason for that is when we treat high blood pressure, the one number. What's the normal blood pressure that we say? 120 over 70, 120 over 80, depending on what book you read. But that's wrong. That's incorrect. If that is a Gaussian distribution, and that's the median or mean blood pressure rate. So some of the people in this room, your normal blood pressure may be 95 over 65. And I'm sure some of you have that blood pressure. Some of you in this room, normal blood pressure for you might be 130 over 75, 130 over 85. And it's been that way for you since you're 16, 17 years of age. However, we need 120 over 120. And that's inappropriate, but we don't have enough information and enough studies to treat high blood pressure persons individually because we don't know what a good person's blood pressure was when they were 17 years of age. That's the number that you should be targeting. Maybe many of you in this room will have that information now that we are supposedly on the side of the records world, and we'll be able to scroll back on that information. And that, when we go to that information or that number, we have to hope that the blood pressure is taking appropriate. Some of these slides I may gloss over because there's so many of them. Speaking of this information, this used to be a 4-hour lecture and a question. I don't want to rush through this slide, but I'll gloss over them and allow you to read up on them on your own if I find that information that you easily read. And otherwise, I'll go through some of the things that I do have in the book. So, this is the case. We'll be going through the JNC78 recommendations, defining a little bit some causes, secondary hypertension, and of course, treatment.
use variables, one greater than 140. Usually go by the systolic rather than the diastolic. The reason for that is as we age, there's vascular remodeling, and this remodeling causes the blood vessels to become thicker. So the blood vessels cannot expand, nor can they relax easily. And so there's a discrepancy. And we're going to go through one of the trials that we've done. Probably several of the trials we'll be going through. This way, you've seen them, the trials that are paramount for landmark trials of treating high blood pressure through the years. This way, you'll have heard of them when you see them in the future. I don't want you to see a trial and say, I never heard of that before. And I'll tell you with maybe one or two liners what came out of those trials. So we need to find out what's the prognosis, and that's going to help diet therapy. You need rereading greater than 140 over 90 in the office. I like to ask the person to take their blood pressure readings at home and reserve comments on that for a few minutes and go back to the opinion. How do I take my blood pressure? How do I monitor it myself? And am I doing it correctly? Have I been taught incorrectly how to check someone's high blood pressure? If there's no target end organ damage and they state that the home readings are lower, the regular suspicion for office hypertension, formerly known as white coat hypertension. If anybody's using the terminology white coat hypertension, they haven't read anything in a year. Perform the ambulatory blood pressure measurements and short looking at the 24 hour monitor. You ask them to, they'll go home with that cuff on their arm and they'll monitor the blood pressure throughout the day over the 24 hours, and you'll be able to see those readings when they come in with that the next day. And you're going to see that these readings are going to differ. When a patient asks me, you know, when do I take my blood pressure? Should I take it the same time every day? And the answer to that is absolutely not. I want to see what your blood pressure readings are in the morning, in the afternoon, and at night before you go to bed. You don't want to turn your patient to do excessive compulsive people and then calling you every blood pressure for the 2,000, 150, or 170. That's the other thing that you're going to have to come out with, not after this lecture, but when you all start practicing. And it's going to affect all of you, no matter what part of medicine or surgery that you choose. Unless it's psychiatry, then you probably don't need it as much, but you should be monitoring for questions if you're doing some of the psychiatry. Or maybe radiology. Is that going to be enough? Anybody does that? Maybe in the interventional radiology. And it's mostly interventional. So you have to look at the blood pressure outside the healthcare setting. And the office is determined that the office of the white coat is not the only factor. And also rises, the blood pressure will rise through approaching unknown to the healthcare body. If the nurse approaches, yes, that blood pressure, the rising blood pressure is the left hand. And the diagnosis of office hypertension can have an intermediate effect or risk of having a cardiovascular event. So office hypertension is not a benign entity, and you should consider treating it. And patients, I've had an experience, will say to me, the nurse takes the blood pressure, and I come into the room, and they, you know, with 160 over 100, the patient will say, take it again. I take it again or not. And many times I do take it again to see that. They still have that blood pressure reading that was 160 over 100. And I ask them to tell me, what does that mean? And if it is office hypertension, again, not benign. And if they have high anxiety, well, if they're having a lot of anxiety that's contributing to it at home, then certainly, there's a problem that has to be addressed and should not be avoided or ignored. I've had patients that have come to me that for years they always say, oh, whenever I'm in the doctor's office, it's fine. But then you look at their kidney function and it's compromised. Well, how do you get that? Well, the doctor never told me I had high blood pressure. And I tell them, well, you've had it for the last 10 years. Trying not to tell them that their doctor may or not be doing anything, which might have been appropriate. So, now we look at something, an entity that a lot of us don't hear about, but maybe this is going to become more and more apparent, and that's called differ versus non-differ. Your blood pressure when you're too tall. on differ, and you are at risk for other diseases, cardiovascular, non differ. Our individuals, either African American, you may have diabetes. Most important one on this list is sleep apnea. Sleep apnea is getting a huge, huge burden on the population today. I've had many, many patients who are working with but many people at a time come into the office and their doctors have tried multiple different medications or regimens and they still can't get the patient to get under control. I send them for a sleep study immediately and sure enough, they got sleep apnea and they don't want to accept it. And they don't want to wear the sleep cap, and so they tend to be among the standard worse. And the blood pressure actually worse than sleep apnea. So the non-dippers have a higher risk of other problems, as you see here, for example, heart failure, cerebral vascular accident, or all end organ damage. Can you convert a non-dipper to a dipper? Yes, but there would be the problems next. Unusual to do so. How do you convert them? You've got to really go back and try to see what their initial blood pressure was at age 16. I had a patient not long ago that came into my office and his blood pressure was 130 over 85. And you start talking to him and he doesn't even have his reading, he didn't know his reading when he was younger. But again, would you treat that? You can see from the JNCA's recommendations, you know you wouldn't treat them according to their suggestions and recommendations. But when you start talking to him, he was a swimmer in high school, very active in college athletics, and so the underlying assumption is that his blood pressure was much lower. You started treating him, there was a lot of significant palpitations, heart pounding over time, getting headaches. Visual problems with the services, treated his blood pressure to 100 over 70, and he's fine. And they're finding out, the other thing that we're finding out too is individuals that were active in high school and college, usually teenage years, in any of these sports, are less likely to develop problems later on in life. So if you have any friends, cousins, children that are in high school, involved in an active sport, not falling, not golf either, another activity. When it comes to having sex, is higher worse than just a little bit high? Yes. So, well, it's just a little bit high, I'm fine with this. No, you should ignore it. Blood pressure does have a direct correlation with the magnitude of left ventricular hypertrophy and microalbuminuria. You should be getting a urinalysis on these individuals, on anybody that has hypertrophy, to assess the presence of proteinuria or microalbuminuria. Urinalysis is not invasive, but many patients that when they come to see me, they have never had a urinalysis. They've been doing urinalysis for 10, 20, 30 years. And they've never looked at their urinalysis. Well, they don't need to get a urinalysis. But it's just, and that's the usual response that I get from the patient. And I say, well, it's easier to take a needle in your arm and get blood than to have to get in your gut. It doesn't make sense. So I just do that. It's only cost a couple of dollars. So it's very relatively simple. You can find out a lot about a lot of information about the person just by looking at the urinalysis, whether or not they have blood and or protein in their urine. That tells me where the person is going in terms of kidney function, not so much the blood work. So if you get the blood work and you see the creatinine and the creatinine, that tells you where you've been. That's your rearview mirror when it comes to kidney function. Your crystal ball, as I like to call it, is the urinalysis. Look at the prevalence of hypertension. More than 73% of patients, or people alive, which means the patient, will have high blood pressure in the 60s and 70s. And people will be, it's a hard thing to expect that a 65-year-old is very active in the middle, and then she comes into your office and says, she's really active, she's thin, she's drunk, very, very healthy, she's not overweight, BMI is within normal limits, eats a healthy diet, doesn't smoke, and now her blood pressure is about 150 or 160, and you've got to tell her that she's got primary hypertension and you need to be treated. got to reassure them. And what I do, you know, what I like to say is, my reassurance is, hey, you would have been in this office 20 years ago, some of them, 20 years ago, if you didn't take such good care of yourself. Do you think that there's a lot of thought process that supports immortality? But we are mortal, and there are certain things that we will develop as we age. One of them is gray hair, another is no hair, another is hypertension. Always forget. We have 4 people, 2 out of 3. So, look at the number. 1 billion people worldwide. Now let's talk a little bit about measuring the blood pressure, because you're not taught this. And if you are taught this, the steps may be inappropriate. So if we're talking about what a person should be doing and how you're supposed to monitor. Before looking at taking the blood pressure, again, I'm not going to read through all of these, to make sure that they're resting. Always use the same arm. I like to make sure you're the one close to the heart, and I use the left one. Sitting down in a quiet place, arm is supported so that a cup is around the arm at the same level as the heart, and the arm resting. Or you're holding the arm. If you're just asking the person to stand there and the arm is hanging, I've seen how many times I've walked in the emergency room and watch the nurses that have been taking blood pressure on people for so long, and the arm is just dangling. No, you're holding the arm up. Sphygmomanometer. Mercury has been outlawed in many states now, but that's the gold standard. We don't have the mercury monitors in our office anymore. And then you have the other two. Sphygmomanometers that are used are the aneroids. They're mechanical. They're fairly accurate. And the digital. You go by the oscillometric measurement. Okay. We use a piezoelectric pressure sensor. And they're converted by microprocessors to get a reading. The wrist one. The one that you put around your wrist. You need a large cup. Larger the cup over the arm, depending upon the size of the person, the better, although you don't want to be wrapping the cup around 3 times and it's not going to stay. You have an 85-pound individual and you use a small cup. No, it's not going to work, of course. But those smaller cups should be used for smaller people. Larger persons get, all of them should buy or have a larger cup. So when I see you, when people see and you come in my office and you're doing a rotation, I usually like to watch, you know, observe and then the patient, although I should. But you say, you know, how do you check the blood pressure? And you see it's being taken inappropriately, and you're up by 5 to 10 millimeters, that can make a difference as to what medication that you choose. These monitors or machines should be assessed and calibrated every couple of years. You only see patients have the patient that you have to say how many times patients will come into the office and they'll tell you what their readings are at home, and you take them and they're completely different. So I always tell them, well, how old is the machine? Where did you buy it? Bring it in, let our nurse take it, and we like to listen to it. We like to also take for the cortical sounds rather than using any one of these 3 digital monitors. Okay, so try if you can and go by the mercury or the analog. But a lot of us will automatically go through the digital monitor. So to summarize, when you're taking someone's blood pressure, try to get a couple of readings left on while they're seated. If you want to assess for volume changes, have them stand up, remain standing for a couple of minutes, and then take their blood pressure. This would be looking for what? What's the static change when you're assessing for volume fluctuation? And also, you're also checking the pulse as well. If you're on a beta blocker, it may not be as accurate because the pulse rate is not going to increase when you go from sitting. So the medications that we have, a lot has changed over the last 70 years. You have RAS blockers, alpha blockers, beta blockers, et cetera. Now, when you go through this, when you go through the list of things that apply later on, the ACA recommends, and many groomers recommend only starting off with a diuretic or low dose of a diuretic or a diuretic.
decision again 57 years ago when you only had several agents, some central acting agents, such as the serpent, which you wanted to use it. If you hear the term essential hypertension, it's being replaced by primary hypertension. Others, they're fighting now over what we should use. I like primary hypertension. Other people will use idiopathic. Other people will say, well, hypertension is like the underlying cause. You used to think that the blood pressure was elevated because it was essential to bring blood to the organ healing the kidneys. And that's how it got the name essential hypertension. And I like to say is essentially we don't know the cause of it. But the prevalence, of course, as we age, there it is, over 60-70% of individuals have some hypertension in their 50s and 60s. Men more than men. That's what we don't know. Age-specific and age prevalence of hypertension. It's listed up a little bit more between sex and ethnicity. Non-Hispanic white versus non-Hispanic black. There's a significant disparity. And so when an African-American comes into your office and you're checking their blood pressure, I expect that individual, but it's more likely that they have hypertension rather than the non-Hispanic black. So it's responsible for 46% more deaths than tobacco use, and third is a list of factors responsible for the burden of disease during life. Pretty hot. Now I'm going to talk a little couple of trials that I'll hit you with. The NHANES trial, the National Health and Nutrition Evaluation Survey, only 31% of those treated had a blood pressure of less than 140 over 90. So what this did was, it took all people that had high blood pressure, looked at them, said that they were being treated and they were on antihypertensive medication, and found out that even though they're being treated, they're not being treated appropriately. So know that your patient, only one of them is going to be well controlled. And there are a variety of reasons behind that. Well, you may mention those. Why is it so poor? So it's poorly organized healthcare. So it's more than when moving to something that we think is more organized. The expense of the medicines, that does not change. Compliance is the patient taking their medicine. Side effects in compliance. One of my first patients as a resident was a bodybuilder in Center City, Philadelphia, and he was in show. I could have been in magazine. And he would come to me and his blood pressure was systolic 180. And he really needed more than one medication. And I had him on four different medicines. Well, he was compliant with them for maybe a couple of weeks and his blood pressure would be well controlled. He'd go down to close to 140 systolic. But what would happen is he wouldn't be able to get an erection. Because of the inability to maintain an erection. I mean, he was young, he was in his 20s. Pictures of his girlfriends, wives, whatever. He says, Doc, how am I gonna perform? Look at this. I need to perform. I can't be taking this medicine. You need to take this medicine or you're gonna get a stroke or a heart attack. You're gonna worsen and you'll be lucky if you die on that because you don't want to live through this stroke. Unfortunately, this went on for a year and on and off the medicine, which is probably worse than leaving things alone. He did suffer a stroke, and he left to the left side of hemiplegic, never lifted again, and walked with a cane the rest of his life. And it's not acceptable at age 25. So be cautious of that. You've got to really try to make an effort to explain to these people how important it is, because many times they're not feeling it. You don't have blood pressure. Sometimes you do. So the question is, how do you address the question with performance, sexual performance or side effect? We'll go with side effects of the medicine and balancing the absolute need for blood pressure control. If you have to, you take them to a walk or take them to a walk through a dialysis center to have that ability. This is where you will be. It's not if, it's when. I mean, if you're lucky, you'll want to be here. anybody else that they're so you're not scaring them. You just tell them the fact. You don't have to take the medicine, and I have to say a lot of times I don't wear a badge, and you're going to do what you want to do anyway. These are the suggestions. I'm going to suggest to you what's going to happen. As long as you have that information, then you're going to make an educated decision based on what I have to say. What you can also do is you have to get a second opinion with one of your partners, and you have to react in our practices. And even obviously, you're not really hearing me, but you're really not listening. Why don't you hear it from my partner? And then you'll get a different people.
And so you can play good doc, work doc, whatever you want to call it. Great question. So the question is, in his case, was it mostly genetic? I mean, I couldn't tell you exactly if that was the case, but we like to think that a lot of Jeff is young, 25, but nevertheless, as you saw in one of his previous slides here, he's still getting certain levels of prevalence. Yeah, 30% of individuals will have. Yeah. So I can't answer that question. Look at anabolic steroids and hypertension. We're going to be going, if you want to hold on to that. Well, you'll see a slide later on that it'll come up nicely. And I'm moving on to another trial, the AST trial, African American Study of Kidney Disease. Goal of blood pressure was achieved despite the high rate of poverty and lack of medical insurance. So it can happen. You can get, that was one of the big outcomes. You can achieve blood pressure control. So don't throw your arms up if you have any patients that you're having trouble with and just with the control of blood pressure. It can happen. So don't be thinking that, why do I put this up there and show you that you can. That is an excuse. Well, they're not going to take the medicine. Oh, they'll never be able to afford it. Everyone can.
You can find the right regimen. These
individuals, if they may get away with paying a few dollars a month for their medicine, you don't always have to go with me. The pill that costs $30 a month or $50 a month. It doesn't have to be there. You're going to get all these pretty boys and girls that come into your office that work for the pharmaceutical industry trying to convince you that drug is the best drug that's out there. And maybe it does have some positive benefit compared to the other ones that are in the market, but it's only likely to be marginal, and it's unlikely to be functional by itself or effective by itself. And that's what we're going to go on to a couple of slides in the future. Multiple risk factor intervention trial, they show that the stylus is more important than the diastyle. So when people come to me and come into the office and they go, but doc, my bottom number is always good. Yeah, I know it's always good. And it's going to be always good. In fact, it's going to get better as you age. And that's what the mystery trial shows. That the diastolic blood pressure drops as we age. And so it's not like blood pressure or the diastolic used to be 90 and now it's 60. Well, it's supposed to happen. You really don't go by that in trying to measure or trying to choose your anti-hypertensive agent. The oral HAP trial, pain hypertensive lowering treatment to prevent a heart attack trial. That showed that you achieve blood pressure control. If you achieve the blood pressure control and not the class of agent, it's more important to see more morbidity. So get the blood pressure down. We've always said it. Pathologists have always said it. You don't care how you get it down, you get it down. There are already trials out there. That's all. Well, no, you need an antihistamine. Oh, no, you need an angiotensin receptor blocker. Oh, no, one needs to be a diuretic. Yes, there are trials out there like that. But all HAP is specific and showing, and very, very strong in the number of patients that they've had that show it. Get it low. But once again, I go back to what I first started with in the very beginning. These trials did not individualize treatment. We're just looking at the Gaussian distribution. So we're stuck. All the trials are like that. Only looking to get them to something below 140 over 80, 120 over 70. So that hasn't been, we haven't really done a good enough job in defining blood pressure management. And finally, the MDRD trial with modification of diet and renal disease, showing that patients with greater than a gram of protein per day, they have better outcomes if their blood pressure is controlled from less than 125 over 75. Okay. We're looking at, that's a significant amount of protein. Normal amount of protein a day, 150 milligrams, this is 10 times, almost 10 times normal, 750 times normal, 7.5 times. Overall conclusions, lower is better. Gold systolic less than 140, or 130 if you have kidney disease or if you have diabetes. You're going to see the combination of diabetes and hypertension, number one, and two causes of why you're going to be in business. They're living longer, they're actually living better. You've got a perfect storm now in the makeup. Every day, more than 10,000 people is retire for baby boomers, and they will, if they haven't already, develop hypertension. And now, when I say perfect storm, you not only have to contend with the baby boomers, you have to contend with the obese adolescent. And it's becoming increasingly prevalent in our society, the Xbox generation, if you will. You're doing nothing. Sitting around playing, playing video games as compared to 20, 30 years ago. If you be active, go outside, play, and now you don't, unless you're in an organized sport, and that costs money. It's easy to pop in a video, or just get on that, get on those video machines and play. So, I'm seeing those adolescents, diabetics, now making it to their 20s, early 20s, and probably over the next 10 years. That's going to continue. Those individuals, probably within the next 10 years, will be having the same significant problems as the elderly population, the baby boomer population. So you're going to have to decide where you're going to put the resources. And say you guys are going to have to decide. You're the ones that are going to be spending that money. You're looking at probably twice as many individuals needing therapy. Those in their 30s probably have a bimodal distribution, those in their 20s and 30s, and those in their 60s and 70s. And higher. That in mind. Epidemiology, blood pressure definitely correlates with the magnitude of blood pressure. Hypertension, heart failure, vascular disease. So you can see that hypertension is atherosclerotic in nature, with reduced vascular disease. And that's how you get the proteinuria. When a person comes in my office and we start talking about management of their proteinuria, I tell them that the creatinine is elevated and you have proteinuria. You do have some visual, or you will have visual problems. Oh, I can see great, I've got 20/20. Now you do, but in the next few years, that's going to change, I promise you. And even though you probably had a negative stress test, that's going to change too. And you probably have significant calcification in the breast. If you have hypertension, you're more likely to have elevated triglycerides, that form of showing you that the diet is terrible, same diabetes, more likely to Yeah. Diabetes and more and more problems today. I'm so many medications to treat it, and you probably treat type 2 diabetes now. Is that only 4-1? The RENAL trial. Reduction endpoints in non-insulin-dependent diabetes, which is independent of type 1. So they found in the RENAL trial that every 10 millimeters increases in solid blood pressure, you increase the risk for developing end-stage kidney disease by 15%. 15%. You're going to see, I don't know if I think this is lecture here on kidney disease or not. I'm not sure. Does that have a kidney lecture again? Maybe I will do it in my own. You see no slide that shows you that the individuals that make it to dialysis are actually the survivors. So most people die before they make it. Slowly deteriorating, and then survivors only need salvation. But you probably not going to need dialysis in your lifetime. That's great news, Doc. Thanks for giving me. What am I really saying? You're going to drop dead before you. So, look at the RENAL study again. This reduction with losartan. If you look at the end-stage renal disease population. You added more partner on, which is dropped here, same thing with the reduction, So just a small dose of more partner in the receptor blocker does improve outcome. And that was in the middle. Elevated risk of cardiovascular begins at the solid blood pressure above 115. So it's usually just normal. So those with the solid blood pressure between 120 and 139,
they're not entirely risk-free. So here's what we call some of the individuals that are called pre-hypertensive. I don't believe in too many. I believe in some. You see, you come from a black and white world, or you come from a shade of gray world. I'm a black and white guy when it comes to management of hypertension. And some of you will think otherwise. You see things in terms of shade, and that's the difference between how they train you, and what your clinical discoveries are, and what your basic treatment levels, which trials you're basing. In case kidney disease, hypertension is the second most common cause. Why? People, more people have hypertension. But even small percentages make up more than enough. And that's what I just did. That's more common than hypertension. Microalbuminuria, greater than 30 but less than 200 milligrams of albumin per day, is defined as microalbuminuria. 6% of the population. So you multiply it out, what does 6% mean? 11 million people. 11 million people. I've got really, really good studies out. That's going to be one of the predictors for, that you get for progression for end-stage kidney disease. Now, looking for the gene associated with essential hypertension, you have ACE polymorphism, 11 beta hydroxysteroid hydrogenase, natriuretic peptide. And maybe something on the receptor abnormality. And the other one that I showed you when we talked about receptor abnormality. And these are very, very few and far between. Do we assess for these? Do we test for them? No, we don't. There's some people that you want to look good, you want to look smart in front of your peers by saying, yeah, I'm going to send them for the 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase level. I've never made it once or twice. So some people would look at me and say, well, I need to be sending it more. No, I don't. More of a chance. Again, I'm a numbers guy. More than 90% chance that the person has primary hypertension while you're looking for secondary causes. Because I want to spend money or I want to look smart. Aging of the U.S. population, and of course, you see, this is what happens to us. And so if we're going to have a significant higher population, an older population, well, we're going to have more hypertension. We're not showing here in this graph is really the type of diabetic. We're going to be doing a comparison here between JNC7 recommendations and the JNC Joint National Committee. Again, these are guidelines suggesting they are not absolute. Because again, this is not the flow chart. We need to do this, we need to do this, and then if that's not happening, then I have to choose one for column A, I have to choose one for column B. No, these are guidelines, so this way you know where to go. And then again, ask the patient, the person, what was it, what was the question at 16 years old? If they have that information, that makes a world of a difference. You can see hypertension, again, I'm not seeing anything live, but again, as I showed in one of those other slides, but there still is significant damage in those individuals that can occur later on in life. So I typically see these people. I don't give them the benefit of the doubt. And in my office, I tell them, look, we're going to start treatment now. They get all paranoid, mad at me. Well, you make these changes, you make these lifestyle adjustments that we're going to be going into in a few minutes, then you can come off of that. But many of the people that you treat, if you tell them, yeah, I'm just thinking that I saw modifications now, I'll give you 6 months. I but put them on medicine now, get them to come back in the office morning, and now they take it more seriously. Yeah, how many people have come in my office? Of course, now, off the top of my head, 5 individuals that are still counting to this day that they're going to be losing weight. Ah, I'm going to get better, doc. I promise you, I'm going to be 10 pounds lighter. And I tell them that you need to be diabetic. You need to go, either banding or not banding, or you need to go, that's the only way you're going to save. Again, what you got to be dealing with a lot. No matter what the patient is, the limitation is, you're liable to be dealing with it. The ACA recommendation, here's the big part, the big difference. It became more lax. The ACA, I think there was more comfort up there, other than that. It was really, really lax. And patients that are greater than 60, they said, oh, your target blood pressure is less than 150, less than 150 over 90. And a lot of my friends are shocked over this. They're not busy enough in the dialysis center, not busy enough in the stroke unit, and they're just becoming more liberal and saying that, yeah, go ahead, you don't need to. I mean, again, we were approaching Europe's numbers. I can see if we were seeing a significant amount of hypotensive episodes in our patients, and that it would make more sense to in treating these individuals, and we should get more lax in treating. But no, if we go back to which trial was it, the Ann Haynes, would show that there was only, we're only treating 30% the goal, even though we're on all these agents. So we can't reach goal, then we change it, so now we have more people that have this goal. Is that going to go up, or are we going to see more stroke and heart attacks and more people on dialysis? And I would think it's the latter that we're going to do. If you're less than 60, yeah, you get more aggressive. You have diabetes, still pretty lax. But all these numbers, as far as the solid increase, which is dramatic, again, coming more or less. And James 7, it was 120 over 70. And one of the other trials that I pointed out earlier, again, was it didn't matter what the drug was, just get the blood pressure down. So we can get it under control. For the other changes, I'll let you read one of these, what drug of choice. To utilize the drug to choose treating an individual, patients with scientific disease should be on an agent or a disease assessment process. Again, living in the lucky world, the lucky era. Survival of the unfit is a lot. Survival of the unfit. Why do I say that? Because now we have all these people that probably would have been weeded out 10,000 years ago that are allowed to be alive and rested. And so the whole thing is choose individuals that are not that will have the ability to pass on the disease for hypertension. So back in the '40s, you have the ganglion blockers, the vasodilators, diuretics came out in the late '50s, calcium blockers came out in the '60s, inhibitors by the late '70s, the calcium blockers, the dihydroxyurea class. There's two different types. Non-dihydropyridine class and the dihydropyridine class and calcium blockers. The dihydropyridine class, they will not unused video on probably stronger antihypertensive agents. And they do not typically affect the creatinine of the heart. The non-dihydropyridine, partisan dopamine, if you will, they're okay blood pressure with antihypertensive agents. However, they do affect the creatinine in the heart. So you have to worry about that. You have to worry about their heart. And if they're on a combined state of heart. Not only is it important to know what the actions of these medicines, you have to know the drug-drug interaction, and you have to know, obviously, the side effects of the medication when they come up, when you're going to choose something, choose a medicine. Sometimes you're going to be choosing a medication because of the patient's side effects. So, for example, are you going to start someone on a dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker if one of their main complaints is, well, it's an edema? And he says, no. Having more salt retention and weight. Direct renin inhibitors later on. Probably you're going to see one of the newer agents that has come out. The trade name is Entresto, combination of a renin inhibitor receptor blocker with sacubitril. Sacubitril is a methylation inhibitor. Methylation inhibitor prevents the breakdown of atrial natriuretic peptide. And so you're going to be hearing more about that medication. The abbreviations we talked about. Neutral endopeptidases. We may be hearing something about these in the future. Neutral endopeptidase, major enzymatic pathway for the degrading natriuretic peptide, as what I mentioned, with the medication on the Entresto. agents came out, I have it on one of the future spots, and they, it's not being utilized anymore. Where the new one is happening, like, actually what I just said. And here it is. I love the truck. It's not on the market. It's still in trial, but the full control is a little bit better. And has been out there and found out that combining the Elepetril is not very effective. Here's the lifestyle modification that I talked about. Weight reduction. It's too readily available. Adopting a DASH diet. Adopting a DASH diet. This is fruits and vegetables, low fat diet. And everybody, I mean, I've got friends that have children in their 20s, in their teenage years and 20s. And they push away the vegetables and the potatoes. And you're going to have a lot more problems than you think. You're going to blow it up on the vegetables. Why do we go to the apple orchard, take our kids to the apple orchard and have fun picking apples? You don't get this anymore. We're going to take our kids to the slaughterhouse. Think about it. So, you got to reduce the sodium intake. That's the salt in there. We need to put salt everything. Sometimes I, you know, try to fool the patient. Tell them you swear up and down that they're not eating a lot of salt. You can see that there are some individuals that are very, very salt sensitive. They don't know how to salt a meal, and they don't check their blood pressure, and it's 10, 20 points, 6 hours or higher. And so they're really salt sensitive. You tell them, I'm not going to salt. Oh, God, I'm not taking an apple. And they'll argue with you. I'll see you have to get a urine collection. And sure enough, they're pouring out the sodium. Now, the hand comes from somewhere. And you tell them, well, you know, there's something in your diet that you've got to find. Lunch meat, processed foods, canned foods, look at a can of soup. You try to, the manufacturers of the soup, you know, you have to get on the breast of a Campbell and dimension them. They'll say that, you know, you have 3-4 servings in a can of that thing, whatever, and 8 or 10 or 12 can. You and I will sit there and drum the entire can. And we've had our daily intake or daily restriction of sodium in that one sitting. The recommendations are should be having more than 2,000 to 3,000 milligrams of sodium a day. The typical American diet takes in about 13,000 milligrams a day. We did, I don't know if you guys did it here in the dietary course, but we did it when I was in medical school. We sat there and we went through and did our dietary survey and diary for 1 week, and we had to submit it. We submitted it, and we were getting back to us how much sodium we had in our diet. We didn't know why we were doing it until after the report. And then we had the average, 13,000 milligrams on a daily basis. Why? From going down the street and having a Jamaican beef patty, going to Taco Bell, McDonald's, you know, that's the typical American diet. It's so easy to get that sodium, and sure enough, it has control, it has contributed to alcohol consumption. You got to tell them to cut down on the alcohol. Oh, why, how does alcohol affect? Two ways. Alcohol has a direct effect on the blood vessels. So they are going to get tighter, increasing and worsening the atherosclerosis. And also, alcohol will then affect or cause the liver enzymes to become more active. When the liver is more active, what's going to happen to the medication that you're taking? The half-life is going to decline more rapidly. So, if I say that this pill lasts 24 hours, but now you go and up down to 10 years that night, well, that medication is going to last maybe half the time, maybe even less. So that's what you're doing. You're revving up the liver, metabolizing the drug faster, and you're making it rather expensive. Of course, smoking cessation. Anybody that smoked today? I don't know what that. I mean, mine, I used to smoke with my professor in the motivation to stop smoking and showing them again. And again, another one of the things for you have the internet by you, don't be afraid to use it. Show them pictures of lungs, show them pictures of diet, COPD, and lungs. If something happens to them, you're not immune to it. Low blood pressure and maybe drug therapy. Yeah, these are all part of human state, similar to what I said earlier, and you get the blood treatment. If you're African American, definitely choosing a thiazide or calcium channel blocker. Non-black individuals, consider the AP or ARB first, along with a thiazide diuretic. I rarely get to choose as a subspecialist. I don't get to choose as the agent. On one, and I think they need to be on one. But for the most part, if you guys are in primary care, OBGYN, and you're considering starting a medication, you'll see in some of the future slides, shouldn't do medicine, you can start to hang on aggressively, and use multiple agents. Use multiple agents because you took or stole some of the approach to hypertension from the oncologist. The oncologist built out, not only in the past, but a good one, by using a combination of medications that treat the cycle and that treat the cell at different cycles in its life. So we, as antihypertensive specialists, we do the same. We need to choose multiple medications to treat hypertension because we're hitting up the different classes. The volume system with diuretics,
Mardi Gras yet?
No. Different classes of medications. Okay. So, if you didn't have the choices of adding on multiple classes of medication, so is it the buying system that's ineffective in this patient? Is it the sympathetic nervous system that's causing the hypertension? Or is it the rest? Or is it a combination of those? So, don't choose just one medication and keep increasing the dose. That's old. When I see people doing that, when you come in the office and run 300 milligrams of a beta blocker, you can't stand up, you have symptoms of sitting down to standing up, you know it was the inappropriate way to do it. Low doses of multiple medicines, and you should be warning the patient about that. You tell them, listen, you know, you're going to be on 3 or 4 medicines, don't be mad at me for that, I just know that I want to limit the side effects of the medication. And when you do that, you'll get control of the blood pressure much, much better. And again, you will limit the side effects. One of the side effects of your thiazide diuretic is hypokalemia. So some individuals have been started out on thiazide 25 milligrams twice a day. 3 to 4 months later, their magnesium is 1.1 or 0.9, and their potassium is 3.8. And then they're getting sent to me. And what are my recommendations? I'll cut down on the thiazide diuretic, and then add on a calcium blocker or a beta blocker, and you get just as good of an antihypertensive result. So here's your flow sheet if you want to look at these recommendations. Some of you are looking at my algorithm approach. I'm not into the algorithm approach. I'm into the, what is wrong with the person. And as I just mentioned, is this a sympathetic nervous system? Is it a nervous individual that I have to treat? Bonding tissue, do they have horrific edema? Or is this the main antihypertensive system? The non-African American, yeah, more likely to be the draft system activation. We should be considering the antihypertensive. And moving up and down from there. And not choosing your strong agents. What are my strong agents in my pocket? Minoxidil and clonidine. Those are the big ones. What are my weak ones in my other pocket?
Probably
alpha methyl dopa. Would you see that being used? Alpha methyl dopa? Pregnancy? Pregnancy, you would have one child on that one file, but it's a pregnancy state. That medication used in pregnant women with preeclampsia. And also the beta. These are the reasons why I'm using these tests, and you know, which age should I get on. But again, I like to say what the issue is coming to them. Oh, and then finally, are they in heart failure? If they're in heart failure, then you know for sure that the RAS system, I like to call it, instead of just saying the renin angiotensin system, the renin angiotensin aldosterone ADA. Right, you got these V5s. And here is the drug that you utilize. So, if the patient has a history of heart failure, the drug that they use for infection. So, with a heart failure patient, aldosterone antagonist, there's two aldosterone antagonists, spironolactone and eptolidone. Probably two of the cheapest, but most underutilized medications. I look so damn smart when I add these medicines, so I'm going to make them a little bit efficient. It's the same thing. It's not difficult. Anybody can do this. But anybody can do it. You know, be careful when you see this. And what else you have to worry about with the side effects of the aldosterone antagonist? A year and a half, they're still 300 pounds, smoking, swim bathrooms, and you've done nothing for them. You've done them a disservice by not treating them. Again, how many of the individuals that you come into contact with are going to listen to you by putting down that fork and stop eating and putting down that salt? It's hard. It's a leap of faith getting a patient to change their lifestyle, and the majority of them will not do it. Speaking not anecdotally,